so desperate for the realms of your glory and the realms of your presence, oh God. Father, we just thank you that we can come and we can enter in. We can enter in. We can enter in. We can enter in. And we can go before the throne with all boldness, making our requests and our petitions known unto you, Father. Father, we just thank you that you form and you fashion every one of us, oh God, to be exactly like you. Oh, thank you, Jesus, to do those things that you are doing, to see by the Holy Spirit what you are doing in this earth today, and us to participate in every way with what you're doing, not with what we're doing. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. We just want to continue in this atmosphere of worship and praise, and don't get outside of this, because as we press in, this is a place of miracles. This is a place of transformation for people. This is the place right here that God launches you and takes you into heavenly visions and dreams and purpose, and shows you what he wants you to do in a clearer way with your life. This atmosphere, it takes you over into the realms of heaven and teaches you how to walk there, live there, stay there. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. And you just want to go deeper and deeper and deeper. You don't want anything to distract you. You want to go deeper here this morning and let God do what he wants to do in you. Hallelujah. And in this place, I thank you, Father, for change. Never, not one of us ever leaving here being the same, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise you, Father. Well, I just want to go over into the place of worship, that all that we are and all that we have belongs to him. And this morning, I was just hearing, bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house, and prove me now. Herewith, says the Lord. God wants us to prove him. God wants us to prove him. Are you ready? He wants us to prove him. Do we believe him? This is a place of launching out and stepping over into a realm of faith that goes beyond what you have and goes over into a supernatural supply of the Spirit. Prove him. Prove me now, says the Lord of hosts. The Lord God mighty in battle, the Lord of hosts, the Lord of armies, the Lord of the real armies of the earth. Prove me, says the Lord of hosts. He will win. The enemy cannot triumph over you when you've got the Lord of hosts on your side. And when you're believing him and you're standing in him, he will win in you and through you. You've got the Lord of hosts on your side. Woo! If I will not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that there shall not be room enough to receive it. You don't even have room enough to receive what God wants to pour out on you if you will fully, completely, wholly abandon yourself, trust in him. And this goes right along with seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Whatever you have need of on this earth, but your eye is not set upon what your needs are. See, too many of us have been trained to have our eyes set upon what our needs are on this earth, and we've got to keep back enough for us to be able to make it through. We don't want to look there. We want to look at what little we have or how much we have, and it's never enough. And we put it in and we let God multiply what we have so it's always enough. If we're doing it, it's never enough. There's always more to obtain because we've got our eyes on a temporal world. But when God's doing it, it's always enough. When you're abandoned to him, when you're seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, he will always supply enough to take care of you. He will always bless you. It may not come in the way you think it should through your job, but God will multiply what you have. He will multiply as you seek him first, as you put him first, as the kingdom is first. He will multiply. And I like what Smith Wigglesworth said. He said, it's not how much of my money am I going to give to God, but it's how much of God's money I'm going to keep for me. And that's abandonment. really realizing that our life is not our own, that we're bought with a price. Now we're hid in Jesus Christ. And we're not supposed to be out there doing anything on our own, but we're supposed to be, Father, what are you saying? And living by the Spirit and walking by the Spirit and releasing everything that we have. You know, I think that's one of the last things people want to release is their pocketbook, because they've got to pay this and this and that and the other. And they are not willing to step out on the water in a place of faith and trust God. I tell you, that place of faith that you have to learn how to trust God in is a glorious place, because he's always more than enough. He's always more than enough. I've never, as King David said, I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed beg bread. So when they put that, they have those signs standing out on the side of the road, and they put God bless at the end of it, you know, give me money, God bless. They don't know anything about God, because his seed never begs for bread. They need Jesus. Without a doubt, they need Jesus, because they don't have the multiplication of heaven in their hand. It doesn't matter if God has to rain it down in your backyard. He will take care of you. He will take care of you. Now, I just want everyone to come and worship, not stopping from where we are in God and the place that we pressed into this morning to go deeper. And we pressed in last night to go deeper this morning. We pressed in this morning where we got, when we got up, to go deeper in God. And we pressed in when we came here in this place to go deeper in God. As we come to worship the Lord, totally abandoned to ourselves, we're coming to worship the Lord with what he's given us. We want everyone to stay in that place of atmosphere of worship. And we have some envelopes in the back if you need them to be able to give by credit card. And the Lord will bless you to pay off that credit card. You step out only in the faith that Father gives you. But we have this new envelope that we've added back there, and it's called the APM Building Fund. And that's because we're doing some new things around here, and we want everybody to participate in what we're doing down here in this room. I think of Haggai. He said, consider my house. He says, you bring in money, and it's not enough, because you put it in bags with holes in it, because you're thinking about you. He goes, consider my house, that it lays waste. So everybody should be considering God's house and be separating something through the week as you're praying and you're seeking the Lord by the Holy Ghost. Not by you. There's a place of knowing here in your spirit, and then there's a place that you get tripped up in your head. Stay out of the head and over in the realms of the spirit. That's where the multiplication comes. That's where the blessing comes. And you can set aside those things, and you can pray for them to come in miraculously. And all of a sudden, money comes in, and you're just like, you know, how many has gotten money in the mail, and they didn't know it was coming? That's happened to me many times. I mean, just suddenly, money comes in the mail, and I had no idea from a source that it, how did that happen? You know, because God wants to give seed to the sower so he can multiply and increase you. That's why people get stingy, because they don't realize that God can multiply what you have, or he can blow on what you have, and you can put your money in a bag that has holes in the bottom of it, and it never increased because you're holding on to your life. Your money represents your life. You're holding on to your life when you hang on to it. It doesn't belong to Jesus. So as we come and we worship the Lord, Dr. Graham is going to come and minister the word to us, and we're going to press in, and we're going to go deeper, and we're going to see the glory of God in this place. Hallelujah. Yes. So come rejoicing and giving to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords that which he has blessed you with. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord, my God. Sarabati Vasubanduva. Yedamanda Rava Sarabidi, the Ramanda Rava Supa. Jananana Sidiki Division, the Bandura Vasupa. Zaramanda Rava Shiriki Divis, the Pomda Rava Sarabidi, the Ramanda Rava City. Baramasarava Sarabidi, the Mandura Vasuka, the Vasika, the Randati. Latantaki and the Namasa to cope, Stigi and the Vasa to Kijis. Laramasa did him on the Ramoko, the Bidi with Rava Tarabashitka. I tell you, unless the Lord builds the house, they that build it labor in vain. They labor in vain. The Lord must build the house. It is the Lord who does it. It's the Lord who does it in us. It's the Lord who does it through us. Everything that we need, he has provided. Everything he wants to do, he's made a way to do it. God has provided a way. But if we labor in our own strength, we labor in vain. We will accomplish nothing. We will go nowhere. We will win nobody. We will do nothing in this kingdom unless the Lord builds the house. It must be by His Spirit. Have you begun in the Spirit to be made perfect by the flesh? God forbid. Such is not true. You have been born of the Spirit to be made perfect in the Spirit, to be filled with the Spirit, to walk in the Spirit, to do by the Spirit. So many places have been run down. They've been beat down. They've been overwhelmed with the things of this world, so given over to the things of this life, so much enamored with the things of this world, the things that they might eat, the things that they might wear, the places they might live, the things that they might own, so enamored of these things that they are beaten down and the Spirit is set aside and they become nothing more than just sort of an empty paper shell of what they once were. We're not going to ever be those people. We're just not going to ever be those people. And if we ever find ourselves feeling the least bit complacent, the least bit, well, just it will be what will be, and we'll just let it go, and we'll just see what happens, and oh, well, God knows. No. You feel the least bit of that? Get upon your face before God and begin to pray in the Holy Ghost. This is what people lose if they ever had it at all. The prayer of the Spirit, the song of the Spirit, the moving in the Spirit begins with giving yourself completely and entirely to the move and the flow of the Holy Ghost in your life. It begins with praying in other languages and other tongues. This is that place that stirs you up and strengthens you in the flow of the Holy Ghost. You don't have it in your life all the time. You are not going to do anything. You're just going to labor in vain because you won't accomplish anything. We can be so smart. We can think like we know exactly what to do. And we've got it figured out. We got every scripture lined up where it belongs. We can show the pattern of how it works. But if it's not by the Spirit, we labor in vain. How many times have I labored in vain? Well, never again. All you have to say today is never again. I won't do it anymore. I will not labor in vain ever again. Not one day, not one hour will I labor in vain. But I will labor by the Spirit. I will begin to pray before my God, saying, Lord, I want to have that place of the flow of the anointing, so that as we begin to press into God, there comes that place where you heard the music team just hit it, just hit the note perfectly. Right at that moment, I heard shouting in my ear, unless the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it, because you could hear the flow of the Holy Ghost just coming forth and stirring up every heart, everyone by the Spirit's responding, going, yes! Yes, okay, I'm lifted up. This is good. This is what I'm looking for. And you just begin to get lifted. We can live in that all the time. We're constantly admonished from here. You can live in that all the time. It's freely given by God to you. You can have it all the time. You just have to choose. You just have to say yes. You just have to agree. And where do I begin to agree? Yes, Lord, I thank you. Yes, Lord, I praise you. Lord, come glorify yourself through me. And you begin to ask for the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit fills you. Yes. This is the wonder of the things of God, that He's done this for us. I'm so excited to think about right now that He's done this for me. He did it for me. He did it for you. He loved you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And we all understand, I believe everybody here understands, everlasting life goes way beyond just a length of time. It's abundance of life. It's the fullness of the Spirit. It is the Spirit that quickens. It's the Spirit that makes alive. It's not your flesh. It's not your thinking. It's not your planning. It's not even the food you eat. It's the Spirit that makes you alive. It strengthens you. It quickens you. It gives you the power to see a difference in people's lives. You can begin to learn how to pray for people. I'll tell you, God will not use you to go out and minister to people very much at all until you learn how to pray for them in private. Until you learn how to get on your face and begin to cry out and say, for this one and for that one and for that one, Lord, bless them. Father, minister to them. Lord, we thank you for all the good things you've given unto them. Lord, help them to open their eyes and see and take of those things that you have freely offered so that they might receive them. Just that prayer of the Spirit in your private place. in that place just between you and God where you begin to lay down your life for other people. That's just this what God told us to do. He said, don't look on the things of yourself. Don't fixate, as Pastor Geneva is saying. Don't fixate on the things of your need. Look to the needs of another. The needs of another. You know, what is God's great need? What did he tell us to pray for? Laborers into his harvest. He has a harvest. It belongs to him. He has a harvest, and he wants laborers for his harvest. That's his need. He's told us what his need is. He said, would you pray for my need? So why don't you pray for laborers into the harvest? And so you pray for the need of God. That's pretty powerful, isn't it? I'm going to pray for God's need. He has a need of laborers into his harvest. I'm going to begin to pray, Father, send forth laborers into your harvest. Lord, fill them with the power of the anointing, the power of the Holy Ghost. Lord, fill them with a yieldedness to your Spirit, that by the Spirit they may begin to break off the bands that hold people in bondage, the things that hold them back from the power of God manifested in your life, out of my life, their life, every life around. Father, who cares who gets the credit? It's all glorifying Jesus. It's all glorifying you. This is what we want to see. This is what we begin to pray for. We've seen bits of it. We've seen bigger than bits of it. I remember God coming upon me in prayer like I'd never experienced before back in whichever year it was when Pastor Mark went to Nepal. Just got hit with it. Just, oh my, I began to see what God was doing and I began to join up with it. You know, people would say to me, well, you need to join up in faith. Well, I didn't really understand what they meant. Okay, I'll give my money and I'll come to church. What am I supposed to do? How do I join up in faith? Well, God will teach you. I can't teach you how to join up in faith. I can encourage you, but God will teach you, because when you give yourself to yield into the Holy Ghost, he will teach you a place where you join up in faith and you go, whoa, that's really it. That's what he meant. And then you begin to see the incredible things that God does. He did amazing things. We're still shaking from what God did. Nepal's still shaking what he did. But we're not going to let it go. We're going to keep praying. Yeah. We're going to keep ministering. We've still got people doing things where we're taking stuff to the orphans there, and we're supporting that. And then obviously the MTC is big involved in that. And there's just a lot of things going on. But first of all, it requires us joining up. Well, joining up comes in that place of prayer. This is where it begins. You lay down your life. I need to lay down my life every day. Lord, I'm not going to take it up again. Lord, I'm yours. Do with me what you will. Because if I try to build the house and I labor in my own strength, I labor in vain and we'll have nothing. And it's so sad to look at how many churches just they start off, they're encouraged, they're strengthened, they're excited, they're going after God, they want the mind of the Spirit, but they get beaten down and they just begin to shrink and dwindle, and they become less than what they were, almost a caricature of what they were. It's sad, and it could be so depressing, except for I know something. All I have to do is turn and go back the way God called me, and I will receive afresh of him the wind of the Spirit. How many times did he tell Israel? He'd say to them over and over again, turn to me. Just turn to me. Just come to me. Lay down your own ways. Come and take up my ways. I will fill you with my word. I will fill you with my Spirit. I will give of you all good things. I will bless you. He just said it over and over again in the worst states they were in. They were just falling further and further, and he kept saying, come, turn. Just come. And this, you know, it begins to fall on deaf ears because people get so ardent in their heart because of sin. Well, Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you for the mind of the Spirit. The first scripture I had to go to today was the one that Pastor Geneva quoted. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. And he's talking about, you know, in that context, particularly things on this earth. You know, you don't take thought for what you'll eat, what you wear, where you're going to live, because if you seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, all that will be taken care of. But it also said earlier in that same discourse, he said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. People say, well, how am I supposed to seek after righteousness? Just hunger and thirst for it. Just ask for it. Say, Lord, I'm hungry for it. Lord, I want more of your righteousness. Lord, fill me with your righteousness. Guess what happens? You get filled. And when you get filled with it, now you're seeking first the kingdom and his righteousness. You got his righteousness. the righteousness we want to have, the whole point was this. I don't want my own righteousness. It's Paul wrote it, not having my own righteousness. But we declare unto you the righteousness of Jesus Christ. It's given unto you. You get to receive the righteousness of Christ Jesus in your life. Now you stand before God, not with your own righteousness. It's not your own. Never will it be your own. You will never again be able to take credit for anything you do in God. Never. In fact, the very thought of it will just grieve your heart, because you will recognize that he's given you not only that which he did through you, but he gave you the very righteousness by which you stand before God. You didn't earn it. You didn't obtain it. You didn't go find it with your great understanding of where to look. You didn't dig for it deep until you could get to it. None of those things. He gave it to you freely. What do you have to do to receive it? Yes, Lord, I'll take it. I believe. That's all he asks from us. Just believe him. Put your trust in him. That's all he asks. That's it. Just trust him. Just believe him. So, Father, I thank you that in this place, never will any of us, not one, oh, Lord, what glory when every single one walks in with this desire. Lord, your righteousness, your moving, your power, your understanding, your prayer, your faith, your glory. Lord, everything about you, Father, manifested in the life of every one of your people, Lord, that we might be filled inside the belly, up, flowing up, out of those discourses, those places of the Spirit, up out of the belly, flowing the Word of God, the power of God, the anointing of God, prophecy, words of wisdom, knowledge, not for the sake of the speaker, but, Lord, for the sake of the hearer. Lord, that they might be strengthened. Lord, that they might be empowered. Lord, that they might be directed. Lord, to do those things that you asked each one to do. Father, that we would be so hooked up with it, we don't even have to be the mouth. We just have to be hooked up so that the mouth that speaks might speak by the Spirit and the Word of God would come forth. Father, this is what we desire. Lord, this is what we're hungry for. Lord, this is what we will have. Lord, we will not back down. We will sing, we will shout, we will pray, we will glorify. Lord, we'll lift up our hands. We will say yes, Lord, to you. We will not back down, Lord God, from seeking after you. We will not become complacent, ever. Not for one moment, not for one hour, not for one day will we become complacent. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. Father, oh Lord Jesus. What, oh God, what a glorious salvation. What a glorious salvation that you have wrought. Lord, you're so good. You're so wonderful. You're so powerful. Oh my Lord, you are so good. That's wonderful. Like that. The Lord, he is so good. The Word of God is powerful. It's a lamp unto my feet. It's a light unto my path. It shows me the way to go. And it teaches me and says to me, walk ye in this. Amen. And all I have to do is say yes. So he looks at the Word. So I want to read a couple things to you. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. In verse 33. This whole chapter is about resurrection. It's about resurrection life. You have been resurrected. You were raised up together with him. Never forget it. Yes, there is a hope of the bodily resurrection to come. Yes, there is. Never forget it. But you've been raised up with him. If so be you've been born from above, you've been raised up together with him to walk in newness of life. This you have. It's already been received by those who called upon the name of the Lord. And it says in chapter 15, verse 33, in the midst of all this resurrection stuff, it says, be not deceived. Because they're having a problem. There's people saying, well, there can't be a resurrection. There's no resurrection. They haven't been resurrected yet. You know, all these kind of things. So don't be deceived. Evil communications corrupt good manners. Awake to righteousness and do not sin. For some have not the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. Now, that sounds depressing. It's not depressing. I want you to get this right. Think of what he's telling you. He's saying evil communication corrupts good manners. You know what evil communication is? I'm just going to make it real simple. It's everything that's not the Word of God. It's just very simple. The Word of God is pure. The Word of God is holy. It's true. Speaking by the Word of God is good. All this other stuff, what it does is it's corrupting. It corrupts. Corrupts good manners, good manner of living. We'll look at some scriptures possibly later, but you can look them up for yourself, where it talks about how you glorify God by the good works you do. Where you stand before people, and by the good works that are manifested in you, you give glory to the God in heaven. I mean, it's you need to choose to do good works. So good works can manifest themselves in many ways. It can be a good work when you give a cup of water to a prophet in the name of a prophet. It can be a good work when you give money to the poor, or when you give to the poor, or when you give them food, or when you give them shelter, or when you call them into the kingdom. Those are all different types of good works. But every good work we do, we don't want it to be evil communication. We want it to be by the Spirit, because we've been raised up from the dead. This is why this scripture, very interesting, sits right in the middle of all this stuff about the resurrection. Just right in the middle of it. He just sort of jumps into it. He's going, you know, if there's no resurrection, why have I done all the things I've done? Believe me, evil communication corrupts good manners. What will happen is when you don't know who God is in your life, you don't know who the Spirit is in your life, you won't do these things of God. You can't do them, because the things of the world will cause you to shrink back in fear. They'll cause you to shrink back in worry and concern about what's going to happen to you or somebody else or somebody you love, or you're going to get all worried about that. But when you know and have hope in not only the fact you've been raised from the dead now in the Spirit, but you have know that there's a resurrection to come, you don't fear them that kill the body. You have no fear of them. It doesn't even enter into the equation. You're not worried about it. And in having no fear, you are able to just do what the Spirit of God tells you to do with no concern about the consequences. Just none. You're not worried about it. People say, well, wisdom says. Yeah, wisdom says a lot of things. But wisdom is principally this. What he says right here. Awake to righteousness and sin not. That's the primary wisdom. Because wisdom, the beginning of wisdom, is to fear the Lord and is to hate evil. So instead of being afraid of all these things around you and using your wisdom to figure out the things of this world, let's use wisdom to do what God said. And what God said was hate evil. Hate evil. Awake to righteousness. He's given it to you. Don't sin. Simple. This is the message that we need to be preaching everywhere we go. Pastor Mark gave us a mandate to everybody we minister to. He said, pray over this one and get this. You get yourself filled with this one. It's basically that the sin will corrupt you. Sin will bring the wrath of God. Sin will destroy your life. Sin will bring an end that is death. Just get that clear so that people understand there is a way of sin and there is a way of righteousness, and the two do not exist together. Amen. Last time I was up here, I was talking about understanding what enmity is. In enmity, there's no compromise. Light and darkness never compromise. Ever. It's not possible. Whenever light is shining, the only way the darkness can be manifest is to hide from the light. It's got to go someplace the light is not. It's the only way darkness is ever there. If we put a bunch more lights in here, we could drive every shadow out. We could drive, you just need more light. Light destroys darkness. The two cannot exist together. The world will teach you and tell you that light and darkness are like two sides of the same coin. They're not. They are completely at enmity with one another and cannot exist together. So, this place right here, awake to righteousness and sin not, for some have not the knowledge of God. What is the knowledge of God? To know Him and the power of His resurrection? Says in another place. To know Him and everything that He's given unto us. You know, when we talk here about perfect love, to know God and that He loved me, this is perfect love. He has loved me, and that I can believe Him and I can accept and walk and revel in that love. I can get so excited that God loved me that I won't be upset when somebody else seems not to, because I'm so filled up with the fact that God loves me. He loves me. He loved me. He loved you. And he still does. And he will not stop. He is, God is a faithful lover. He does not stop. He will do everything he can to draw you closer to him, to help you to understand the greatness of the gift. So that he says here, some have not the knowledge of God. And he said, I speak it to your shame. You say you're walking with God. You say you're doing all the things God wants you to do. But you've given yourself to a place where you've begun to accept sin as acceptable and normal, even in a small way. You've begun to accept that, you know, God's really not that interested in what I'm doing. Just a little bit. You just begin to think, well, I'm going to go do these things, and I'll get back to with God later. You may not say it quite like that, but that's kind of the attitude of the heart. You're busy about many things that you're doing. And you begin to lose sight of the knowledge of God, who is with you forever. He's with you. He's in you. Know you not that you're the temple of the Holy Ghost? You're his temple in which he dwells. You are... the dwelling place of God. He's never leaving you. He's never forsaking you. He's always there. Some of you don't have the knowledge of God, so that you begin to think that he becomes afar off. He's watching you from a distance or some such nonsense. We begin to think that he's far away from us and he's not interested in every moment and everything that goes on. He tells us how interested he is. He says he numbered the hairs on your head. He tells us that he's touched in his heart every time a sparrow falls. I'm not touched in my heart when a sparrow falls. I'm just not. But if I touch heaven, I begin to know the things of God. I begin to have the things of God. Oh, Lord, the Lord's interested in everybody. Well, I'm interested in ministering to these people because they're my kind of people. I kind of like them. I'm not so interested in ministering to those people because they're really not my kind of people, and I just kind of want to avoid them. We have preferences. God has none. He loves the one as much as he loves the other. He loves them. He doesn't divide people by height or by width or by, you know, brightness of eye or by skin color or by length of hair. He doesn't divide people like that. He looks and says, there's people of the light and there's people of the darkness. And if they're people of the darkness, then the people of the light need to be reaching out to the people of the darkness to bring them into the light. That's the only difference. That's it. Otherwise, he loves everybody the same. Regardless of their culture, we get so filled up with our culture. It doesn't, regardless of that. It's the culture of the kingdom. What's the culture of the kingdom? It's what we were talking about up there. It's the mind of the Spirit. That's what the Holy Ghost does. As the Holy Ghost sweeps through the room, begins to lift everybody up. And, you know, we need to find a place where it's even bigger, where it's even greater. I know Pastor Mark for years has pled with people, would every one of you come filled up with the Spirit when you walk in the door? Every one of you at the place where you're right at that point when we begin. Then we will see what God will do. Well, how do we get there? I mean, Lord, is there any way for me to do that? Yeah, give yourself to praying in the Holy Ghost more. If you pray in the Holy Ghost for 15 minutes a day, make it 30. If you pray in the Holy Ghost for 2 hours a day, make it 4. Just go deeper with God. Why? Because God is going to do in you things you couldn't do in yourself. Because if you labor to build the house, you labor in vain. I tried for a long time, very, very much, in my own strength, because I didn't know any other way. And I hadn't grown up with any of this. And I just thought, okay, so it's time to get this done. So let's go at it. Let's do it with everything I knew. And God honors zeal up to a point. He's real happy with that. But he's going to try to turn you and say, now listen, what that's going to lead you to, that evil communication will lead you to bad manners. It's going to corrupt your good manners. I love you. I understand what you're doing. I know that you're zealous for my house, but let's move you around here. Come on. Over here. Now you need to go this way. But I'm not accomplishing anything. That's all right. Stay right here. I'll work in you. Now pray. Give yourself to prayer. Give yourself to prayer. I'm too busy. Got too many things to do. I can't do it, Lord. I just don't want to do that. Because what you find is that everything in the world, every evil communication in the world, it corrupts the good manners. It makes it harder to do. It makes you think you don't want to do it. It makes you think you don't want to give yourself to it. It makes you think you don't want to lay down your life. It makes you think that it's too much and it can't be measured by men. Yeah, it can't be measured by men. It can't be. You will never be accepted in God by any measurement that you can come up with. I'm better than you because. I'm less than you because. Every one of those measurements is an evil communication that corrupts good manners, good manner of living. Every one of them. So I let all of that go. I look at everyone and say, I love everyone just the same. I love by the Spirit of God. Do I know everyone in the flesh the same? But he told me, it doesn't matter. I don't want you to know people after the flesh. I want you to know them after the Spirit. Oh, if you're going to know people after the Spirit, is it going to be about how much you know about what they ate for breakfast or where they went to school? Or it's not going to be about that. It's going to be about what the Spirit of God says. And the Spirit of God is doing what? Love. It's love. It tells us to love one another. Love one another. Love one another. Over and over. Love one another. Love one another. How do I love? Pray in the Holy Ghost. Pray in the Holy Ghost. I would rather you pray in the Holy Ghost for me than pray in your understanding. I just would. It really would be better for you and for me, I promise you. And the same goes for if I'm praying for you. You really don't want me praying for you the way I understand things ought to be. You want me praying in the Holy Ghost. Now, when you pray in the Holy Ghost, could you pray in a word that you understand? Yes. But it's always going to begin with praying in languages you don't understand. It's always going to be there. It's always going to be that you give yourself to, praying in the Holy Ghost. That has to be what we do. The number one reason churches fall out of their passion and fall out of their place in God where they're making a difference in the lives of people around them, the number one reason is they stop flowing in the Holy Ghost, if they even ever had it. But they stop flowing in the Holy Ghost. That's it. That's the number one thing that we need. Amen. We need to pray in the Spirit continuously. When we're at home, when we're at work, when we're in the car, and when we come in, and when we go out, and everything we do. We're praying in the Holy Ghost. This is what we need to do. And you might say, well, I can do it more. I'll try. It's much simpler than that. It's just say, yes, Lord, I know I need to. Father, come and do it in me. That's it. That's all you need to do. He'll do it. 15 minutes of Holy Ghost prayer moving, coming up out of your belly is worth more than 5 hours of what you can do. It doesn't mean you should be driving in to just have 15 minutes. But it's just saying we'd rather have the prayer of the Spirit than anything else. That's what has to happen. And I prayed many of my own prayers, many, 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 many times, because I didn't know better. But the Lord, He'll teach you. When you're hungry for righteousness, guess what He does? He fills you. When you ask Him for the Holy Ghost, what does He give you? The Holy Ghost. It's very simple. Very simple. So we look at these things and we understand that we want to have good communication, not evil communication. So I read that one. Let's go to the book of Ephesians. And see some more about this before we get to the end. Father, we thank you. Oh, Lord. Okay. Verse 10. That in the dispensation of the fullness of times, He might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven, which are on earth, even in Him. When you have His righteousness, you have been gathered into Him. He said, I and you, you and me, right? Yes. Who all may be made one in Him, in God. So this is what He's talking about. In whom, in Christ also, we've obtained an inheritance, What is the first fruits of our inheritance? The Holy Ghost. That's the first fruits of our inheritance. That's the first thing you get. Yes. It's like, wow. It's the proof of your inheritance. It's like if you're going to inherit $1 million and they say, you know what, we're going to give you $10,000 as a sort of the earnest money, and when you reach your age of accountability at 21 or whatever, you're going to receive the rest of your $1 million. Here's the first part. I mean, you're pretty excited because this is the evidence of the fullness of all that you're going to receive. The Holy Ghost, as absolutely marvelous and wonderful as it is only the beginning of the inheritance that we have in Christ Jesus. And we haven't caught up with that part yet. We haven't caught up with the little bit that we get them first. That's what we need to catch up with. So we've obtained inheritance. We're predestinated according to the purpose of Him who works all things after the counsel of His own will. He's really not interested in your will. That we should be to the praise of His glory who first trusted in Christ. That's our goal. It's to glorify God in our bodies, in our lives, in our spirits. We want to glorify God. This is it. That's all we're after, that He would receive glory. When is He going to receive glory? When we do the works of Christ Jesus, the good works of Christ Jesus. He's going to receive glory for that. I read and posted on my Twitter account the other day some YWAM missionaries were at the border of Jordan and Syria ministering to the refugees. And there was a guy from ISIS whose task was to go down there and kill people. It was his task. He was told to go in, infiltrate into the camps, and then create some mayhem and kill people. At least that's his testimony of what he was supposed to do. So he comes down to do his job, but he gets stopped because he's seeing these Christians laying down their lives for these people, and he can't understand what's going on. So he has to begin to ask, who are these people? What are they doing? And he ends up getting saved, gets filled with Jesus. And he ends up testifying that now he's a Christian and he's no longer wants to go and murder people and kill people. It's a wonderful story. I loved it so much. It's like, it's incredible. But they see your good works, something's going to happen. That's why Jesus says, you know, by your good works, you're going to win somebody. If they give you the left cheek and smite, give them the other one. So you hit that one too. You know, if they take from you one thing, give them the rest. You minister to people by doing good works, not fighting. We get really into, we got to go kill them all and prevent them from killing us. But no, Jesus says we need to go lay down our life for them all, that they might be one to be like us, so they can be part with us in this inheritance. So we want to be to the praise of His glory, in whom you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel, the good news of your salvation, in whom also after you believed, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. That's the earnest of our inheritance, the Holy Spirit. We've been sealed with Him. He's been given unto us. He's been put within us. He's been given to us that we might manifest these good works in the earth. He's here to teach us, lead us, and to guide us. He's here to show us all things, to manifest the Word, Christ Jesus, to show us what the Word has to say, to interpret it for us, to teach us about it, to show us the way to go. He's been given unto us. Why do we ignore Him? And this is what people do. Christian people do. They just ignore the Holy Ghost and go about seeking their own righteousness, trying to prove to everybody that they measure up to some artificial measure created by men. I don't measure up to any measurements of men, but I do measure up to the measure of Christ Jesus because He gave me Christ Jesus. I got Christ Jesus inside of me, therefore I measure up to the righteousness of Christ Jesus because He gave it to me. That's it. It's that simple. He gave it. So now I can stand in boldness of faith, declaring that I stand before God righteous in His sight because He gave it to me freely. Just sit here. It's yours. You can have it. Whoever you are that believe, you can have it. The Holy Spirit, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of His glory. That's just commenting. Just, you can go read, you can insert 1 Corinthians 15 right there. Go read 1 Corinthians 15. It'll explain that entire sentence, but in a whole chapter. of what's going on. There's going to be a bodily resurrection. We have great hope, expectation for a bodily resurrection. Whether we go by way of the grave or we go by way of the catching away, we know that we're going to have a new body given unto us. And we're going to have eternal life with God. We know that. And knowing that, we don't worry about the future ever again. We're not worried about what we might accomplish in this earth. We're not worried about how people might see us. We're not worried about anything. What we're concerned about is this. Lord God, I want to glorify you in my body and my spirit that belong to you. This is all I want to do. And I can't do it laboring by myself. I can't. But I can do it in you. So Father, do it in me. Do it in me. Lord, do it. Wherefore, verse 15, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. So he's modeling for us what we all should be doing, right? So when we see somebody that gets, you know, touched by heaven, they get moved on by the Holy Ghost. Pastor Mark goes to pray for somebody, whatever it might be, and you just get touched by going, oh, that's so wonderful. I'm so blessed to see their life being blessed, whatever. Then what he says, I heard about their faith and their love, and I see that. What am I going to do? Pray for them. Because what's the world going to do? It's going to try to take it away. Joshua sings that song, the world can't take it away. No, the world can't take it away unless you let it. Right? Yeah. Verse 17, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe according to the working of his mighty power. Wow. It's amazing. This is what he's done in us. And where does the mighty power begin? Speaking in tongues. It was the first thing that happened in the book of Acts. Acts chapter 2, they all began to speak all. Notice the all, all. All began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave utterance. And then out of that came the sermon of Peter. That, you know, that's what I call it because it's what I learned it as early on. But, you know, it's really the sermon of the Holy Ghost through Peter that it comes and he begins to speak and tell about this great salvation, and many souls get saved. And what do they continue to do? Get filled with the Spirit. Get filled with the Spirit. Every time something's happening, the world's coming crashing, somebody goes to prison, there's some oppression, they're being told not to speak, they're being threatened of their lives, what do? They go to prayer, they get filled up with the Holy Ghost, and then it doesn't matter anymore. They don't care anymore about the ones who threaten their lives. They don't care what they're gonna take away from them. They don't care. They're really not concerned about the things of this world. They're concerned about glorifying God. How are you going to glorify God? Good works. Did James, I love to talk about this one. This is one of my favorite things. You got James and John, cousins of Jesus, as we understand it. They're two men. They follow him. And they're known as the sons of thunder. Now, there's no separation between the two in all of those discussions. But one of them is the first apostle who gets killed, and the other is the apostle who lasts until the end. It's very intriguing to think about. These two brothers that were together, and you'd think, oh, they're gonna be together and work together in the ministry for the rest of their lives. But one of them was the first one to die as a martyr. So did he glorify God less than his brother John? No. God will do with you what he will do with you. And what he's going to do with you is not what he's going to do with me. It's just going to be that way. Peter got wrapped up in this when Jesus told him, guess what, Peter? You get to die. When you're old, you'll get to live till you're old. But when you get to die, they're going to take you where you don't want to go. And Peter understood he's going to have to go to the cross. Because remember, I think whether it's true this way or not, Peter's the one who got really, I'll die with you. But when he saw what they did to Jesus in the crucifixion, he didn't want to sign up for that. I don't really want to sign up for that either. That's just brutal. It's just awful to think about. Well, Peter got to go glorify God doing that. And that's what Jesus told him. But then he turned and said, well, but what about John? What about John? He said, what is that to you? If I will that he lives until I come, what is that to you? It doesn't matter what somebody else is doing in the Spirit. It matters what you're doing. That's what matters. Walk in the Spirit. Walk in the Spirit. We're all different. We all have different callings. And some of us may go to die when we're very young, even. And some of us may not. We may live till we're very old. You walk with God. He will glorify in Jesus however he wants to glorify in Jesus in you. He will do it. Even if he tells you, you're going to go and they're going to take you when you're old, where you don't want to go. You definitely do not. Peter did not want to do that. But he did it. In fact, he said, I'm not even worthy to do that, so hang me upside down. So they hung him upside down. Amazing. Well, I digress. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you. There's one more thing I wanted to read in 1 Peter. 1 Peter. Chapter 1. It's just so wonderful. Okay. Verse 13. Wherefore, and you always want to know what the wherefore is there for, because, you know, you understand. But under the, he's talking about this salvation, okay, that we've just talked about a bunch. And he says, wherefore, in light of this salvation that God has wrought, okay, it's a wonderful thing, gird up the loins of your mind, because that's where we are. We've called upon the name of the Lord Jesus. We've received his salvation. We've been made one with him. We've been given the first fruits of the Holy Ghost. Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind. Be sober and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Wow. As obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lusts in your ignorance. Not fashioning yourselves according to all the things that you think you need. I need more clothes, I need more food, I need a bigger house, I need a better this, I need a better, all that stuff that Jesus told you, don't take any thought for that. Don't worry about that. I'll take care of all of that. So this is the same thing. I want you to see that we're talking about the same thing, okay? But as he which has called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. We read the thing in the middle of 1 Corinthians 15 where he said evil communication corrupts good manners. He's telling us, let your communication, let your conversation be holiness. That's separated unto God. It's God's communication. It's what God has to say. Not what you think God has to say, but what God actually has to say. How are you going to know that it's going to be by the word? Many times we say things, but I remember this, and I thought that, and I meant to say this, and I thought you said that. That's basically nonsense. We'll just stick with the word of God. Love people. Don't judge them in that way. Because it is written, it's written in Leviticus 11, be ye holy, for I am holy. And if you call on the Father, who without respect of persons judges, according to every man's work, past the time of your sojourning here, in fear. For as much as you know, you were not redeemed with corruptible things, as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers. Their vain manner of living. It was vain, because it was by what? Why did God Father find fault with the first covenant? Because it required man to do it. And he found fault with it, because he recognized it was impossible for man to do it. So he gave us his very life. He just gave us his life. And this gets back to understanding that because of the sin of Adam, every one of his descendants sinned. So we had the sin of Adam that comes upon it. Remember, sin's onto, you know, onto 2-3 generations. So I guess you could say if you get 2 or 3 generations in a row that don't sin, you could eventually get to the perfect man. But it never happened because every generation sinned. And because of the sin that passed upon all men, all sinned, right? And so these things happen. So it's just understanding that. And this conversation that we receive by tradition, there's a conversation to do something by a strength that we did not have. And so they tried to do it, but they couldn't do it. There were some who broke out of that and recognized, I know my Redeemer's coming. I know my Redeemer lives. They broke out of the bondage of it and walked in the Spirit up to where they were able. You know, that's why Elisha had twice as much of the Holy Ghost as Elijah. You know, there was a measurement on it. We've been given the fullness of it. I mean, that's incredible. The fullness of it. So that when we talk about this, you're not redeemed with corruptible things, like silver and gold from your vain conversation received by traditions of your fathers, but you've been redeemed with the precious blood of Christ, as a lamb without blemish and without spot, who was truly foreordained before the foundation of the world, but manifest in these last times for you. He was made manifest. He was talked about from way, way, way back and prophesied of over and over and over. I mean, if you just go through the old covenant and look at all the prophecies of the one who was to come, I mean, it's voluminous, just huge numbers of things. Some very overt and some a little bit more subtle, but they're all there. Are we having trouble? Do you want me to switch? In Jesus' name. Hello? Do you want me to turn it off? I'll get this. There we go. Who by him, verse 21, do believe in God. Scripture says over and over, only believe. You just have to believe. God will do all the work. That raised him up from the dead and gave him glory, that your faith and hope might be in your great ability to understand these things. Now, that may have, hope might be in God. My hope is in God. Seeing ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren, see that ye love one another with a pure heart, fervently. Fervently. Love one another. So how are we going to love one another? We're going to pray fervently for them. We're going to give ourselves continually to the needs of somebody else. We're going to pray for everyone that we see, and we're going to ask the Holy Ghost to bring them to our remembrance. You can get out your list, write everybody's name down. Let me see who I got to pray for you, pray for you. Am I praying for you? Am I praying for you? And, you know, and all these things. Or you can do this. Holy Spirit, bring to my remembrance you want me to pray for. Begin to pray in the Holy Spirit. Begin to say, Lord, I'm praying for the people of the church. I'm praying for the people that are coming. I'm praying for them. I'm asking you, Lord, minister to them, touch them. Bless them, fill them with thanksgiving, fill them with praise, fill them with your Spirit today. Lord, cause them to do things in every thought where possible. Lord, move upon them that they might accomplish in you things that glorify the name of Jesus. Lord, that people might be broken free out of the powers of darkness, out of the bondages of this world. Lord, out of the blindness of their mind and of their eyes. Lord, that they cannot see, they cannot understand, they cannot hear, they cannot know that they are in prison. But Lord, shine the light that they might see the light. Father, cause them to know how to walk with you. You're just praying for people. You just give yourself to prayer, and it just comes up out of your belly. It comes up out, and you begin to pray in the Holy Ghost. Then you pray with the understanding. Then you pray in the Holy Ghost. Then you pray in the understanding. Then you pray in the Holy Ghost. You pray in the understanding. You're just giving yourself to it. Every moment that you can, every moment of the day, you do not forsake loving the people of the church and then loving the people outside and remembering that God asks us to do something for him. He has a need. His need is that there are laborers that go out into his harvest. That's his need. He has a need. He's asked you to pray for his need. We ask people to come. Do you need something from God? We're going to ask you to come up here and we'll pray for you. And we'll join our faith with your faith, believing that God will touch you and you will receive the thing that you've asked of God. And we see miracle after miracle after miracle, and just an encouragement from people, and they're moved upon by the Holy Ghost, and they're strengthened in their faith and strengthened in their trust in God. And this is wonderful things. But God has a need too. His need is that we pray that laborers be sent forth into the harvest. We just pray for it. Encourage people in it. And we're just going after it. Lord, send forth laborers. I thank God, Lord, that there were those people that were willing to go to the border of Jordan and Syria and lay down their life. That's a dangerous place. And they lay down their life just giving and loving people. You know, I don't know all that goes on with that or who does what, but they gave their life. And if even just the one soul came to Jesus, that's wonderful. That's good. They're just blessing people. let's lay down our life one for another, praying that you be filled with all the fullness of God. And you go forth, as it says, go forth weeping, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come rejoicing, bringing the sheaves, the harvest with him. Wow. We can do that. Go forth bearing precious seed. Here's the word of God. Just going forth. Lord, bless it. Lord, touch people. Father, do miraculous things. So let's pray with that. Just everybody pray with me. Let's pray in the Holy Ghost. Let's pray the understanding. But let's begin to pray for laborers in the harvest. Father, in Jesus' name. Lord, we thank you for the prayer of the Spirit. Oh, Sudama, she de Gama, Sadevet, Dia, Mandorobo, Suda, Vatiata, Takada, Vashuda, Dimenda, Dabaya, Tadabosh, Tobosha, Lada, Nadada, Niam, Mandorova, Sudevide, but the Manta, the Vasu, the Via, the Manta, Taya, Lada, the Mosu, the Vasha, the Gidamanda, Rava, Sudevide, Bianda, Radarada, Yandara, Kashi, the Gadana, Masudov, Suda, Vadia, Tarava, Lana Mandarava, Suda, Vadia, and the Mandurova, Suda, Veda, and the Yandaragasi, Lada, Vosu, the Barada, Mandarava, Sede, Gadana, Mandarava, Suda, Kadabi, the other Bahada, Vashutuha, Lana Mandias, the Vandurovosh, the Lord, we thank you for the prayer of the Spirit. Lord, we thank you for the manifestation of the Holy Ghost. Father, we thank you for the light that shines, Lord, in your people. Lord, that they might be laborers in the harvest. Lord, that you would find those people that are willing to go, willing to do what you said to do. Father, willing to manifest your glory. Lord, not their glory, but your glory. Not their ability, but your ability. Lord, not their mind, but your mind. Not their will, but your will. Father, you in them doing those things that are good and righteous and holy. Father, manifesting the glory of God in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for it. Oh, hallelujah. Father, we pray earnestly, Lord, that in this place there would be a greater depth, Father, of each one of us preparing our heart to come before you in each service, Father, to be moved on by the Spirit, Lord, to be so filled up with good things, Lord, that there be on our face the glory and the presence of the joy and the love and the peace and the long-suffering, Lord, the meekness, the gentleness of you, Lord, flowing up out of us, Father, that we would be filled with it, Lord, that we might see a harvest come into this place, Lord, that we might see people redeemed, set free, Lord, delivered from the darkness. Lord, the people in here that have had recurring trouble with anything, Lord, that it be broken in Jesus' name. Lord, that yoke-breaking anointing that just takes and destroys that yoke, that they might walk free, knowing that you filled them up with the ability and the strength to walk in the Spirit and in the righteousness of Christ Jesus has been freely given unto us. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. We thank you, Lord Jesus. The gates of hell will not prevail against the church. They will not. They cannot. In Jesus' name. Why don't everybody stand up with me? Raise your hands to heaven. Begin to glorify the Lord. Lord, you're so glorious. Your word is so wonderful. Your power is so mighty. Hallelujah. We give you praise. We give you thanks. We give you glory, Lord. Oh, glorify your name in all this earth. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. We glorify you, Lord. We glorify you, Lord. Now, if there would be anybody in here that does not know that they've been set free and made a part of the family of God, that they've been given a new spirit, that they have not the old one that they were born with, but they have a new spirit given them by God, I want you to come. I want you to come and declare, I need to be born again. If there be anybody like that in this place, you never want to forsake giving an opportunity for anybody who's just uncertain that they've been given a new spirit to come. And if there be anybody with a need, they want prayer, you can come up here. We will pray with you. We will join with you. Believe God for great things. Do mighty things in your life. And he will, in Jesus' name, whatever that need might be. hug one another, love one another, pray for one another. In Jesus' name, amen.